Now, friends, it is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Richard Fogerty. He earned his PhD in history at the University of California, Santa Barbara, and is associate professor of history at the University at Alabama State University of New York. He is the author of Race and War in France, Colonial Subjects in the French Army, 1914 to 1918, and he is the co-editor of Empires in World War I, Shifting Frontiers and Imperial Dynamics in a Global Conflict. You can find those books inside the museum store, and during lunch there's going to be a book signing as well, so keep that in mind. He is an editor of the Africa section of 1914-1918 online International Encyclopedia of the First World War. He is currently working on a book about the French colonial empire during the First World War entitled Greater France and the Great War, and a longer-term project about Muslim North African prisoners of war in Germany, tentatively titled Under Strange Moons, Islam, Captivity, and Contested Identities During the First World War. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Richard Fogerty.
Okay, don't could be terrible, and then you'll feel silly. So I want to start by thanking Laura and also seconding her warm thank you to Haley Sheriff. I'm pretty sure that I was a bigger pain in her neck than any of you in arranging for me to get here and do my thing. And part of the reason for that is that I was supposed to be here last year in person. I don't know if are there people here who were here last year? So I zoomed in so you'd have seen me as this sort of big head on the screen here. And I had to zoom in because my father was very, very ill. And a few days after the symposium, he passed away, on my birthday, in fact. And that might sound tragic, but he was suffering a great deal. And I've had a few more than 50 of those birthdays, and that was really the best present I could have gotten, an end to his suffering. He was a veteran, and he is buried in a national cemetery in Saratoga Springs in New York. And so I'm reminded when I've been there to visit where he's interred, I'm reminded of remembrance and loss and all of those things, even though he lived far beyond his years of service. And if you many of you will have had this experience. If you visit these places, you will see the generations move, right? So they bury folks according to when they die, and so you can see the way the generations are passing away. So if you go to where he's buried, it's Korea, 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 Vietnam, Korea, Korea, Vietnam, Vietnam, right? And so as each generation passes away, and we just had a really wonderful talk about that kind of remembrance and those kinds of sites in Europe itself. So I just wanted to start with that because I thought it had some relevance, and I just want to say how really glad I am to be here in person. My itinerary had never taken me to Kansas City before, and this museum, as I just told Laura a few moments ago, this museum is really something else. I'm extraordinarily impressed. And I've been all to all the ones in Europe, and this is at least as good, if not better than them. Don't tell them I said that. Their American cousins. They're not always thrilled to come in second place, but I'm actually going to come back to fathers and sons in a way at the end of all of this. So stay tuned. So I'm going to begin by talking about the year 1923. The 1923 is the hinge that's been identified for this event as the hinge on which memory turns from celebrations of victory and triumph to invocations of peace. 1923 was an important year, that is to be sure, and so I'll start there. And as I'm a specialist on France and its empire in the First World War, I will spend a lot of time talking about the French colonial empire, what the people at the time, people in France, called Greater France, or La Plus Grande France, France plus its empire. And that entity was one of the things that made this a global war, a truly global war, in ways that I'll talk about here in a moment. And it helps make the memory of the war and its commemoration, its remembrance, all of those terms are important. None of them mean quite the same thing, as I think many of us have thought about extensively. But it helps make those things global, right? It renders them truly worldwide in the same way that it rendered the war worldwide. And so I'm going to talk a lot about empire and questions of race. The war made those kinds of questions, those issues, more relevant and fraught in the years after 1918 and long after 1923, as millions of people in France and its empire continued to struggle with finding meaning and understanding the effects of the Great War. And so so I'm going to begin with, as I said, with I have a mic in my face. I don't think I need another mic in my face just now. As Sean pointed out, I look a little like Britney Spears, which I've never worn a mic like this, and I didn't think I looked like Britney Spears, but this offers me the opportunity to express my disappointment that Taylor Swift is not here to see my, because I understood she comes to really important events in Kansas City, and I thought this was one of them. This is the joke that my wife inevitably made as I was leaving for Kansas City. Okay, so enough of that. So I want to begin with three events in 1923, and focus, as I said, on France and think about the war and its memory as global. So the first thing that I want to say about 1923 is it's the year that the war ends. And now you're all slightly embarrassed. They invited this guy, and he doesn't even know when the war ended. But in fact, 1923 is the end of the war. It is the signing of the Treaty of Lausanne in July of 1923. This formally ends the war between the Ottoman Empire, now Turkey, and the Entente powers. This was necessary because earlier attempts had failed, and sorting out what to do with the remnants of the Ottoman Empire was one of the most pressing international geopolitical concerns of the day. In fact, it is what brought many of the combatants into the war against the Ottoman Empire. Getting Italy to join the Entente, in fact, had a lot to do with promising it pieces of the Ottoman Empire. I know from my touring of the museum yesterday, there's a political cartoon to that effect in the exhibit, in the main exhibit. So the signing of the Treaty of Lausanne settled some of the outstanding issues of the war and formally brought it to an end. And I want to also make the case that the war was not over in 1918. It only ends in 1923, in part because France and Britain, in fact, are fighting in the former Ottoman Empire in places like Iraq and Syria in the years between 1918 and 1923. The French and Turkish forces, in fact, engage in open combat against each other in Cilicia in 1920, 1921. So this underlines the global nature of the war and the way in which the French Empire contributed to this. And I'll note, and you'll see this becomes much more important, men like these men here who are pictured in 1917 in Alsace, they're Africans in the French army. They and North Africans as well fought in these campaigns in Syria and in Cilicia against the Turks. And so again, this is part of this argument that I'm making, that the war and its memory are global. The second thing I want to mention that happened, I'm forgetting my slides. Okay, so I always joke with my students that you know that it's a boring lecture if it starts with a map, right? But this is maybe a nicer crowd than my students, but this is, the Cilicia is this area in here, right? You can see Syria and Iraq. So this is the treaty that defines the nation, the modern borders of the nation state of Turkey, and liquidates, in a way, liquidates the Ottoman Empire. So, and so the next thing that happened in 1923 that I want to talk about is actually a little bit earlier. In January of 1923, French and Belgian troops reoccupy the Ruhr region in Germany. And they do this in order to enforce reparations payments. Germany had suspended them, and they move into this area in order to force payment in kind, to put pressure on the German government to resume financial repayment of the reparations. And this provokes civil disobedience. You can see here, I love this picture of this this old man and this French soldier. I don't know exactly why he's menacing him, probably for bad language or something. But as you can imagine, the French-Belgian operation did not meet with universal approval in the region. It provoked civil disobedience. You can see some of the sort of tense tense standoff. Is you can see French soldiers here and over here, and the German civilians. And then also, this is a protest by, of all things, gymnasts. But Germans protested and saying that the Ruhr would always be, it says the Ruhr will always be German here, where we'll be servants to no one here. So it provokes a tremendous amount of resentment. What does this have to do with the global war? I mean, after all, this is an internal European event. The French officially and publicly, internationally, promise not to use African troops in this occupation. And they do so because their use of African troops in Europe as soldiers and then as occupiers of the Rhineland, in this very same area, really, after the war, provoked a huge international scandal that I'll talk about here a little bit more. So, the French use of its troops from the colonies to fight and to occupy in the events of the Great War provoked a tremendous amount of controversy, not just among Germans, but among French allies as well, who had different ideas about things like race and colonial hierarchies than the French did. The final event that I'll talk about in 1923 is that this man, a man named Albert Sarrault, publishes a book. And this is, okay, so a lot of people have heard of the Treaty of Lausanne, yes? Right? Yes? Okay, good. Because I don't want you to be passive, you'll go to sleep. And maybe fewer, but people have heard of the occupation of the Ruhr, yes, in 1923, okay. Has anybody heard of Albert Sarrault and the publication of his book? Of course not, right? Only nerdy French historians like me would ever have heard of this thing. Albert Sarrault published a book called La mise en valeur des colonies françaises in 1923. Why does this matter to anybody but somebody like me? He was the minister of the colonies in France at the time, and he had formerly been the governor general of Indochina, what later became Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia. He was the governor general of Indochina twice, once before the war and once during the war, with a gap in between. And then in the 1930s, he served twice as prime minister of France. So he's a pretty important guy, if you're French, at the time. And he argued in this book that France had to make better material use of its empire. And this mise en valeur, it's a very difficult word to translate into English, but it means sort of rational economic exploitation, right? That France had to get serious about making its colonies pay. And the reason for this and the sort of backbone of his argument was that the Great War had proved that this was possible. He said, the colonies demonstrated their vitality at the hour of greatest danger. The colonial enterprise showed that it, quote, paid. So the French colonial empire had helped make the war global. I'll return to this point over and over again. The French colonial empire had 50 million colonial subjects in it, added to 40 million people in France. That meant that over 5% of the world's population lived under direct French control. So thinking about the war, to all of these three events, I want to just sort of give this kind of make this kind of impressionistic case that in 1923, all three of these events showed clearly that thinking about the war, its significance, its effect and legacy, and what was worth remembering about it, was an imperial global affair. And that ways that these ways were evident in this critical year of 1923. So so now let me turn to this is the French Empire. I was aggrieved yesterday, as a French historian, to in the video that starts the tour of the main exhibit. I shouldn't complain about the museum when I've just said wonderful things about it, and I'm here at their invitation. But it said that the British Empire dwarfed all other empires. Well, it was bigger than all other empires, but it did not dwarf the French Empire, right? And I don't say that because I'm a booster of the French Empire. Like that's silly, right? I'm glad that it's gone, but I'm an advocate for understanding its importance, right? And so the French Empire, you can see France here, the hexagon, as it's affectionately known, and you can see this vast, vast territory in Africa, Madagascar, which is a lot bigger than it looks on a map, all of Indochina, and all these outposts here in the Indian Pacific, in the Caribbean, and so on. So the French Empire is worldwide. I don't know if you can say the sun never sets on it, but it's plenty big. Okay, that's the case I want to make here. And then, so I want to move on now to come back and talk a little bit about what I mentioned when I talk about the occupation of the Ruhr, and that is the Rhineland occupation earlier that followed immediately upon the armistice of November 11, 1918, into the early 1920s. So as I indicated before, the French army used African troops from Africa and from Indochina to occupy Germany at this time. 500,000 of these soldiers had fought for France in Europe during the war. And this was, of course, controversial with the Germans, to be sure, but also, as I mentioned, allies. So it was only natural that the French would use these troops to shore up French security and authority in the immediate aftermath of the war. It was also highly convenient, right? You could demobilize white soldiers who were also voters, right? You could demobilize them more quickly, get them home to France where they wanted to be. You could, the troops were available and they were stationed nearby. Mongin's 10th Army was nearby. And also, the record here is really clear, in official private correspondence, the French officials talked about not about trying to humiliate Germany, which was the idea that the Germans had and that many around the world had, but that in fact what this was an opportunity to give French colonial subjects a concrete idea of French victory, right? These soldiers had been important to France's victory. They had seen France invaded, lain prostrate, much of it destroyed, right? And so before they go home with those kinds of ideas about France, French power, and so forth, to have them go and occupy Germany gives them a sense that that France is powerful enough to have won this war against this powerful fellow nation in Europe. So the use of these troops caused a huge international scandal, and put tremendous pressure on the French to end what people called the Black Horror on the Rhine, or the Black Shame, Schwarze Schmack in French, La Honte Noire. The French had introduced, the idea went, savage Africans to the civilized white European continent, endangering white women with animalistic black sexual depravity, right here. And you can see this, that this is German propaganda, this idea of these soldiers, this is a North African and this is a West African soldier, as savage, and they've taken the famous French slogan, liberté, liberty, fraternity, equality, and made it brutality, bestiality, and equality, right? That the French ideas about equality were depraved and degraded and deeply problematic for white supremacy. So and this, as I said, was an international scandal. There were meetings, huge rallies held in Great Britain, in the Netherlands, in Portugal, in the United States. Have people heard of Edie Morel? You've read Adam Hochschild's King Leopold's Ghost about the Belgian Congo. Edie Morel is a great humanitarian, left-leaning socialist activist who led one of the first human rights campaigns in the history of the world, to end the Belgian atrocities against Africans in the Congo. Well, Morel also, the next most important thing he did, was agitate against the black scourge in Europe. This is an article that he wrote. So this fired public opinion all throughout the world against the French and their policy of the occupation of the Rhineland. So now it's worth pointing out that investigations at the time and since I want to show you this. Okay. And I do it not to shock you, or maybe I do it to shock you, but I want to give a sense of the super hypercharged racial animosity and exactly what they were talking about. This had to do with black sexuality. It had to do with defending the purity of white women, right? And I think if we have to, as ugly as these things are, we have to look at them if we want to understand them and ever perhaps do anything about them. And here you have, again, this is maybe a little bit tamer, but another depiction of this sort of animalistic black sexuality going after the German woman here. You get all of this, the sort of racialized sense of what this was all about. So the French, in response to this, conducted investigations. The American army conducted an investigation to find out if any of this stuff was true. Were Africans and North Africans raping German women, defiling the occupied nation? And in fact, there was no evidence whatsoever. In fact, probably because of tighter discipline among these troops for racial reasons, they committed crimes, sex crimes, at a much lower rate than white troops did, right? So there's really nothing to this. This is about the racial imagination of the day. So what does it have to do with memory? This has to do with memory that we begin to see in 1923, this promise that we won't do this again in the Ruhr, even though what you said we did in the Rhineland isn't 100% true. Still, we understand we won't offend British, American, and yes, also German sensibilities by using these troops in the Ruhr occupation. And so this idea of racial defilement stuck so well that, one, France had to promise not to use these troops in the Ruhr in 1923. It stuck so well that legends of so-called Rhineland bastards animated German politics for decades afterwards. So this is a German boy who is the product of consensual sex. I mean, that's the kind of sex that was going on, was consensual sex between transactional, commercial sex between white German women and non-white colonial subjects in the occupying army. And here's a picture of a couple of these children known as Rhineland bastards and made, as you can imagine, became symbols of the nation's shame, its degradation, its quite literal rape after the First World War. And as you can imagine, the Rhineland bastards featured prominently in the Nazi imagination and in Nazi propaganda. Okay, so now to move to memory in different places and different ways, memory and commemoration, remembrance. So this, I want to talk to you about two monuments, one in Bamako in Mali, in West Africa, and one in Reims, in France, known to British and American troops, and maybe some of you, as Reims, right, where the cathedral is. None of these names are possible to pronounce because, of course, they're French. Has anybody been to Reims? Yeah, okay, so you've seen the cathedral there and all the damage. And it's a very famous site of, in French propaganda, a site of German bestiality, right? The degradation, the destruction of French culture, of this Catholic symbol, the cathedral where French kings were traditionally crowned. So anyway, why am I talking about Reims and Bamako, and why am I talking about them at the same time? Because both have, had, you'll see it's kind of hard to know what verb tense to use when I'm talking about this, but have a monument known as the Monument aux Héros de l'Armée Noire, or Monument to the Heroes of the Black Army. And so in January of 1924, so we've moved on to 1924 now, in January of 1924, and then again in Bamako, and then in July of 1924 in Reims, a monument was unveiled, this monument. This is how it looks today in Bamako. Okay, so it's still there in Bamako. This is how it looked in France, in Reims, at the time. You can see they're identical, right? Identical monuments. And the reason for building this monument in Reims, because in the spring, summer of 1918, during the big German offensive that ultimately failed, these soldiers from West Africa, known as tirailleurs sénégalais, so soldiers recruited from all over West Africa were known as Senegalese, even though only some of them came from what is actually Senegal. So these tirailleurs sénégalais, these black African soldiers, fought heroically and tenaciously against the Germans at this time, defending the city of Reims. And so these monuments were intended to express gratitude for that sacrifice and that service. And so, this monument, the one here in France, and it says to the veterans of the, it shows where they fought, at Reims and Sars and other places. What that was supposed to symbolize, the one in Reims, was to symbolize the debt the nation owed to its colonial subjects for their aid. And then the one in Bamako is designed to show the debt that France owed to colonial peoples, to show this cooperation. As usual, especially with colonial monuments, but with all monuments, they do all kinds of work. Some of it contradictory, all of it at the same time, right? So for French people looking at this monument, there you can see, or they could see, a confirmation of France's civilizing mission in the colonies. Look what we have done. We have created a population, we have developed a population in the heart of West Africa that is loyal enough to us, to the French ideal, to French civilization, to defend it from the barbarism of the Germans, right? And so it conveys not just the debt that is owed to that is owed to these folks, but it's a self-congratulatory kind of thing as well. And the message here in Bamako is that France's civilizing mission is good. It's so good that your ancestors, these heroes, fought to save it. Right, so it's doing some commemorative work. It's celebrating these soldiers. There's no question about that. It's their bravery, but it's also sending more subtle messages about French colonialism, which is important to note is based on notions of racial superiority and hierarchy. So I'm showing you this new picture of Bamako and this old picture of Reims. Why am I doing that? Because in 1940, in the Second World War, the Germans occupied Reims, and they blew up this monument. And they blew it up because it was a symbol of the French victory, certainly, but there are lots of symbols. If you've been to France, you know there are symbols everywhere of the French victory in the First World War. But they blew it up because it was a reminder of the black shame, the black horror on the Rhine, right? This is where it is these men in the German especially the Nazi imagination, who have produced the Rhineland bastards, these men who ultimately carried out the worst kind of degradation of the German people after that war. So they blew it up. In 2013, the monument was finally, it took a while, as you can see, 73 years, it was re-inaugurated, rebuilt with a new base. There was I won't bore you with the story, but there was a very large and very typically French controversy over whether to have the old base or the new base and what this meant and all of these sorts of things. But these are extremely contentious sites of memory and memorialization, because this site now serves as not just a memorialization of the past, but of the present. What is the place of the ancestors, of the descendants of these soldiers who now live in France, who are some of whom are immigrants, some of whom have actually been living in France for several generations, some of whose grandfathers fought in the war, their fathers may have fought in the Second War, and so on and so forth. And so, again, this is the way the memory, even in a place like Reims, where you go to see the cathedral and drink champagne, this is the global war, the global memory of the war is so important and so evident. And so now I'll turn to another monument, and this one is known as the Domba et Dupont monument in Dakar in Senegal. So all of the monuments that we're looking here are distinctively colonial. People who study them will tell you, because they emphasize through the posture of the soldiers, through the relationship between the white soldiers who are depicted sometimes in these and the black soldiers who are there, they depict hierarchy. They depict the inequality between white and black soldiers. It's worth noting that these soldiers, in many, many very concrete ways, and I've written a book about this, were treated with more equality and more welcoming than African-American citizens were in the U.S. Army in this war during this time, right? That does not mean that there was not racism. That does not mean that there was not discrimination. There are all kinds of really complicated realities working at the same time here. So this monument, this is the one in Dakar, again known as the Domba et Dupont, so Domba being a typical typical name of West African at this time, and Dupont being a kind of stereotypical name of a Frenchman at this time. So they stand for the sort of everyman soldier from each of these two areas. This has been moved twice since its construction. So it depicts two soldiers, as you can see, a Frenchman and an African, and the Frenchman is raising up his hand, and with a laurel wreath for symbolizing peace, and it says up here, vers la victoire, toward victory, right? And so for 60 years, it was part of central Dakar, right? It was right, in fact, out in front of, it was in Tashir, place called Tashir Square, facing the National Assembly, so at a very important place in official Dakar. But in 1983, Domba et Dupont, the sculpture here, the monument, was suddenly exiled to a Catholic cemetery on the city's outskirts. In a country with a predominantly Muslim population, this is indeed a marginal and obscure location. The decision, why move the monument? Why sort of demote it in this way? Well, this had to do with political controversies. And so at the time, the president, Abdou Diouf, was facing a lot of pressure from people in Senegal because he seemed to be too friendly to France and the French neo-colonial kind of relationship with Senegal. And so one way of showing his bona fides as a true patriotic Senegalese was to say, no, we're not going to give this pride of place to this symbol of cooperation and hierarchical cooperation. There's really no question who's in charge, when given the postures and so forth. Here it is, of course, the white Frenchman. And so he said, "Well, okay, I'll move it." And so they move it, and the square itself was renamed the Place Soweto, right after the massacre, the shantytown in South Africa. So you get a sense of the racial and colonial, neo-colonial politics of the time there in Africa. So Dombasle Dupont remained in this sort of Catholic cemetery in exile until the summer of 2004, when it was moved again. And so in Provence, southern France, in August of 2004, the French government held an event, a commemoration, which honored, for the first time, really gave pride of place to honor the contribution of colonial troops to the victory in the Second World War. As some of you may know, two-thirds to three-quarters of the troops who, under French authority, who fought into France and helped liberate France, were in fact from the colonies. They were not white Frenchmen. White Frenchmen were trying to figure out whose side they were on at the time, and whether they wanted to fight each other or exactly what it was they wanted to do. And so colonial soldiers did a lot of the fighting. This was finally acknowledged and commemorated in 2004. And so, inspired by this, President Abdoulaye Wade established a Journée de Tirailleurs Sénégalais, a day of remembrance for African soldiers, to honor African soldiers from both world wars who had fought for France. And so this paved the way for Dombasle et Dupont's great comeback. They're moved, this statue was moved to the Place de la Gare in the center of Senegal, of Dakar. If you've ever been there, I have. It's kind of hard to get to because the traffic is totally loony around this traffic circle, but and it's been renamed the Place du Tirailleur. If you can make that out right here, right? That's that French term indigenous soldier, a colonial soldier, as opposed to a white French soldier. So, what this was a way to bring to kind of try to reconcile this memory, because France still has a very complicated relationship with its ex-colonies, as many people here may know, often hierarchical, often exploitative, but shot through with all kinds of contradictory sentiments and motivations. So, so this is another way in which the memory is global, and it works in these mysterious and contradictory ways. And here it is up close. You can see the two of them, right? And again, these monuments are always this way. They do depict camaraderie, right? There's no question about that. But they also send subtle messages, particularly to an African audience, about who's in charge, what's really going on, why they're serving, what they're serving, and so on and so forth. Okay, so this is a very famous propaganda poster from the war, because they had these journées, these day devoted to the African army and colonial troops during the war itself as well. How much time do I have? Okay, I'm gonna go quickly through the rest of this so there's a bit of time left to talk afterward. And so you can see that here, again, there's sort of contradictory images. You can see that the soldier is depicted in clothes that are all ragged, not really the same way as the white Frenchman who is behind him here. Certainly, this is the kind of aggressive savagery that this soldier is displaying is what you really want on your side in this kind of warfare or any other, I suppose. And there's these sort of positive messages, right? You can see a tree here in full springtime bloom, an unlikely sight at any time on the Western Front, right? But that's symbolizing the victory that these soldiers will bring. But here, again, the soldier is depicted as wild, as savage, as other in many ways. And then here, I call attention to the other stereotype of these soldiers, and that is the good-natured, simple child. And this is particularly evident in the most famous depiction of these soldiers from the war and beyond, and this is, I'll bring this to memory. Bananya. Bananya, does anybody know what Bananya is? Have people had this god-awful stuff? It's banana-flavored hot chocolate, right? And I have a horror of things that are flavored like bananas but aren't actually bananas. So I won't drink this stuff. I'll talk about it, but I won't drink it. And so this is 1915. The soldier, it's the typical kind of racialized advertising that you can see in Uncle Ben's and Aunt Jemima and all this. And we probably all have some familiarity with this. It's very controversial among Africans, certainly at this time and beyond. The great poet and the first president of the independent Senegal, Léopold Sédar Senghor, talked about wanting to rip the smiling faces of the Bananya off the walls of Paris because these advertisements would be posted on walls. And it's so, you said the sort of happy-go-lucky, the big grin, the big child kind of stereotype. And then also here, I like to call attention to this. If you know French, this is not good French, right? Ya bon? Is associated with Bananya for decades and decades after this. At the time, it appears on, it means is good, right? It's hard to give you a sense of how grammatically incorrect it is, but it means it's good, but no French person would say this. An African might say this, an African who speaks imperfect French. They were stereotyped for this kind of language, as their simplistic minds couldn't grasp the complexities of French. There's a great deal of discussion of that in the French army. So this, and I'm going to move through these quickly because you don't need much argumentation to see the way this memory becomes more and more racialized, more and more abstract, more and more depicting the kind of colonial hierarchies that I'm talking about. The slogan remains, now the soldier has become a disembodied head, now the soldier has become a couple of bananas, and further. And look, I want you to remember this visage here. So this, the chechia, it looks like a fez. This was the distinctive headgear of these soldiers. Here again, right, this is, we're getting up through the 1950s, 1960s, 1970s, to here today. This, you can still buy this today, right? And what has disappeared is Yabon, because some activists in France, immigrants and their descendants, black activists, have demanded that it be removed, even though it's now owned by a Swiss company named Nestle that you may have heard of. But here, they cannot seem to get rid of the hat, certainly, but not get rid of the wide grin and the exaggerated lips and all of those things about the racialized sort of imagery. Okay, I'm going to finish now. You'll be grateful to hear, I'm sure, with one last story. I'm a historian, I can't resist telling stories. And this is brings it back to fathers and sons, different father and son here. This man is named here Claude Madonbazi. He is a West African veteran of the Second World War. You can tell by looking at this picture, his uniform, and the equipment there, that this is not the First World War. This is a veteran of the Second World War. He died in April of 1914 at the age of 90. He died in a small village in southwestern France where he was living. He was, as I said, a veteran of the Second World War, but his father, Abdelkader Madonbazi, was a Senegalese veteran of the Great War of 1914, 1918, or 23, take your pick. And the son's memories of his late father encapsulate some of the ways that the war affected people and their memories in living in France's colonies. As Claude, the son, remembered, his father, quote, let himself die when he was ill with pneumonia in 1932. This assimilated African, living in France, speaking French, having dedicated his life as a career soldier to serving the French nation, refused to speak French during the last few months of his life. According to his son, this was the result of his tormented conscience, his guilt over having helped recruit thousands of Africans to fight for France, many of whom died, right? And so this story in a lot of ways encapsulates some of the things I am trying to capture here in this talk. The effects could be extremely complicated. The memory does not work in simple, and remembrance and commemoration, memorialization, none of it works in simple, uncontradictory ways. Some folks who fought in, some Africans who fought in the French army came away more outraged than ever by racism and colonial exploitation. Others came away more invested in the order that employed them and gave them status and even a uniform. Things never could be and never were simple. The story of Claude Madonbassi and his ancestors is a case in point. His great-grandfather and his grandfather helped build French colonialism in West Africa. They served in the French army as well, and his father did, as I've already said. He ended his life in France itself, his father did, but he no longer spoke that nation's language. As for Claude, he was a decorated officer and veteran of the Second War. He even fought to help keep Indochina and Algeria French. But when Senegal became independent in 1916, he returned to the nation of his, the new nation of his birth, and served in the new nation's army, and then as Senegal's ambassador in several posts, including the UN. So he's an important figure in that country. And then he engaged later in life in a struggle to unfreeze the pensions. And maybe some of you have heard of this. The French government, in a fit of vindictiveness, when these nations became independent during decolonization, they froze the pensions of the veterans, African veterans who'd fought in their wars, froze them at 1960 levels, or at the moment of decolonization. So they still pay them, but at much, much reduced rates as time went on. And so the veterans of both wars, and Indochina and Algeria, fought a public relations campaign to get these unfrozen. And this is what Claude said, the son. When one loves this nation of France, it is difficult to understand this baseness, this stupidity, this disgrace. So Claude Madonbassi, like his father, died in France and was buried there 100 years after the beginning of the Great War. But he remembered the war, he remembered his service, his father remembered the war and his service in deeply complex and contradictory ways. And so that's the lesson, I would argue, that the global memory of the war can teach us. Thank you.
Friends, we'll be taking your questions online. If you have a card and you prefer to write your questions that way, just raise your card, come down to a microphone on either side, and Rick, I'm going to begin with a question from Stefan online. What do you think were the fundamental differences, if any, between British and French use of colonial troops?
Okay, yeah, there were fundamental differences, absolutely. The British, of course, employed soldiers from the British Empire in the First World War, but not much in Europe. No Africans served the British Army in Europe, no West Africans, no Africans from East Africa, no Africans. They served in Africa itself. Indian soldiers served on the Western Front. Some of you may know Ernst Jünger's Storm of Steel, and in 1917 he encounters, there's this great scene where he encounters Indian cavalry fighting, dismounted of course by 1917, fighting against him. But they're some of the very last Indians left. A very few Indian troops were there of the 130,000 who came to France to fight in 1914 to 1915. The British, partly for reasons of the weather was not kind to people from tropical climates, it's not kind to anybody, northeastern France is horrible. It's a little bit like upstate New York where I'm from. But the British above all, and they state this reason very plainly, did not want to upset racial hierarchies in Europe. Right? And so they were absolutely happy to use Indian soldiers, a million of them, to fight in the Middle East against non-white enemies, the Ottoman Turks, and in Africa itself, but absolutely not wanting to do so in Europe itself. And this points at this is why the Rhineland occupation and the French use of troops from French colonies was so controversial in the first place, because not because the French weren't racist, although they like to say that this was why they were willing to do this, but because of this idea that French culture was so superior that these soldiers would absorb French culture, owed what they called a blood debt to France for the civilization that France had brought them, that they could serve. Now, absolutely, the French army was more egalitarian than the British army and the American army in the First World War, but it was not an egalitarian paradise. So you could become an officer if you were African in the French army, much more easily than you could if you were a black citizen of the United States. However, you could only rise so far. You didn't carry a marshal's baton in your knapsack like every private, a white private in the French army, as the saying, the Napoleonic saying goes. So that's the crucial difference, is the French had not colorblind or non-racist ideas about non-white people, but different kinds of ideas about non-white people. So that led to a very different kind of result in the war itself.
Hi, as a Vietnam historian, I have to ask, did the Vietnamese experience mirror those as the Senegalese and the North Africans serving with the French?
Okay, so yeah, Vietnamese soldiers or Indochinese soldiers served. I went on too long, and I only talk about Africans, so I couldn't also add North Africans and Vietnamese. But Vietnamese soldiers served in the French army, to be sure. A couple of battalions served in combat, but the 50,000 other, most of the 50,000 soldiers, the vast majority of them, served as staging troops and as labor. Why? Because the French racial ideas said that, well, they're smaller, they are more delicate, they're not good fighters, which they would discover in the 1950s to be a kind of a gross error, right? There were Indochinese troops, many of them used as labor. Africans, Algerians and West Africans were known as savage, aggressive for racial reasons, and used as shock troops, and suffered correspondingly high casualties, as you can imagine. So the Indochinese soldiers were absolutely there, and they had the same kinds of odd and often contradictory experiences as soldiers from these other areas. Racial ideas were different about them, but they, for instance, found that they could date French women, white women, openly, for the most part. American troops, when they arrived, white American troops, were a little bit disturbed, in some cases a lot disturbed by this with Indochinese, North African, and West African soldiers. But again, the French, with respect to Indochinese soldiers and others, the French ideas were deeply contradictory. It looked like colorblindness to W.E.B. Du Bois and others, but it was a lot more complicated, the reality. It was a lot more complicated than that. Thank you. Oh, the Vietnamese were known as, they did get respect for one thing, they were known as inexhaustible. So they served as drivers on the Somme battlefield because they were supposedly easier on the machines, because they're gentle, I guess, but they also didn't get tired. They were tough, right? It's a very strange set of ideas about these, filtered through all these sort of racial stereotypes. Anyway, thank you for that question.
We'll take our next question from this side and then
sure.
From the other.
When you look at the Blue Book, which Brands had mentioned in his first presentation, you see an awful lot of parallel positions where the colonial troops of France mm-hmm. are right next to the American troops,
yeah.
Much more so than I think the white French troops. Was there a reason for that? And also, possibly, was there a preference?
Yeah, I don't think there was. I think that it was mostly that these are the armies that are there, and this is the order of battle that existed. It was, you know, there were a lot of reasons not to put white American soldiers next to colonial French French units, right? Mostly having to do with American racism. But a number, as you know, a number of American soldiers are black, and many of them serve in French uniform under various forms of French command at different points in 1918. So no, there was no conscious effort to do that. But like the New Moroccan Division and others were just important parts of the units that were the armies that were stationed in the areas that the Americans came to occupy. There are some really interesting examples of Americans encountering these African soldiers and others and not really knowing what to make of them, right? Because they did often serve at the front, very close by.
And this is going to be our last question.
Well, I might defer to the gentleman that just came down because I was going to ask a question about the African American perspective from the French side as compared to the colonial. So if this gentleman has a different question, go ahead.
All right. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Yeah. Kind of a question, kind of a statement. The very earliest Banania ads, they said, ça c'est bon. And what it did is the ad depicted the white doctor helping a wounded black soldier. Mm-hmm. Okay. And Banania, for the record, was developed by that doctor as a medicine. It has cereals in it. Yes, it does have banana in it. That particular soldier made it, by the way. And it was put in a different light. Now, I grew up over there in the 60s, so I knew I've been drinking banana for the last 50 years. I have. I'm still
And it must be good for you because you're doing fine.
It's doing
good
very
for
good.
You. I should reconsider.
But I think just saying that it's chocolate with banana would be kind of a misconception because it is it was developed as a medicine, same way camel bear was. Most people don't know that one. So the original ads did say what the soldier said, soldier saying, this is good. And I don't know if you've ever seen those ads. Mm-hmm. They're quite old, okay? And maybe in the future you might want to touch on that part, okay, that it was more of a medicine. But, because, you know, things get lost in history, as we all know. Things just kind of evolve that way. So, the latest ones I think are horrible, the depictions that they have. But I just wanted to bring that up. And by the way, my grandfather was one of the 10,000 tirailleurs, the white ones, that were sent into Germany to kind of police the black force. But I haven't gotten any stories from Grandpa. He's long gone.
So yeah, really quick, yeah. Promise.
No worries.
Give me the side eye there. Absolutely. The Banania advertising develops. It develops before where I began in 1915. Absolutely. It changes for a reason. Ya bon becomes the slogan for a reason. The depiction offends Africans for a reason, and it offends them at the time. Not all of them, because again, these are really complicated realities that I'm trying to work with, right? That an African man would live into his 80s or 90s, having spent his whole life serving France, and then decide that the French are base and stupid in certain ways. It tells you about a complex relationship. Right, one that's not easily reducible to stereotypes. Absolutely, that the advertisement are simply racist. They actually celebrate these soldiers, but they also, at the same time, cut in a different way as all the commemoration I tried to talk about did today. So, absolutely, as far as African Americans, W.E.D. Du Bois and some African Americans who served in France, as many of you probably know, did come back with the idea that the French weren't racist, that they were colorblind, because the conditions there contrasted so unbelievably radically with the conditions in the United States during one of its most racist periods, which is really saying something, mm-hmm. Right? I'll just give you one quote. One soldier from Alabama writes home to his mother, and he says, these French people don't bother with no color line business. The only time I know I'm colored is when I look in the glass, mm-hmm. Right? This extraordinary experience of being treated like a human being by white people, mm-hmm. that made a huge impression. Mm-hmm. At the same time, there are these contradictions, these complexities, mm-hmm. Right? That we also have to hold together in our minds at the same time.
I am actually going to ask you one more question, but I'm going to make you say just yes or no. Sorry, Rick.
You can't make me do
anything. I know, right? Samantha Ness, who is a teacher in Arizona, and she says this. Would you say the treatment of African soldiers during World War I and then World War II was a turning point for the national movements leading to decolonization and disintegration of the French Empire? Isn't that terrible, y'all? Terrible.
Maybe.
Perfect. Great no, answer, Dr. Fogerty. Great answer.
Real quick, it is French veterans, African veterans of the French army, are some of the most conservative voices in the decolonization movement. They don't want, they've invested their lives in France, right? And yet, some of them also return home and serve in the new nation's army. So the decolonization is a process. And the First and Second World Wars are key moments in accelerating that movement, but it's not just as simple as sometimes we like to think. Well, they served in the French army, they were exploited, they weren't paid their pensions, they got angry, and they got independent, right? It's a lot more complex than that. I get that's the epitaph for my talk. It's just too complex.
And if you want to dig deeper into that complexity, buy his book at the museum store or online. Also, if you want to find out some more about tirailleurs, pardon me, I do not speak French well. If you already speak French well, you might have already seen the with Omar Sy, but it is coming to the United States sometime soon, so keep your eyes peeled for that. And friends, if you would please join me in thanking Dr. Richard Fogerty.
Thank you.